Hey everybody, how are you? Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training. How's everybody doing today? Another beautiful day down here in Florida. It's actually our last week down in Florida, and right from here, I go to Virginia. I'm doing a seminar next weekend in Virginia. You can actually go to rvdogtrainer.com because I travel around North America in my RV. I actually travel the world doing seminars. If you don't know who I am, you can always check us out at Solid Canine Training. There's a link right up there to our Facebook page. We've got a wonderful, beautiful training center up in Providence, Rhode Island. 9 awesome staff up there, 3 great trainers that are just doing a fantastic job. We specialize in aggression rehab, behavior modification, on-leash and off-leash obedience, but actually, we can train your puppy. So I want to talk to everybody about the things that you probably should be doing, in our opinion, to get your puppy on the right path. We don't have the opportunity normally to work with a ton of puppies. Most of our clients get a dog that's already anywhere from 6 months to 2 to 3 years old, so we don't get a huge amount of puppies. But when you do get a puppy, boy, you've got the opportunity to do some really, really incredible work with these dogs. And what you can do is you can eliminate hiring us on a boarding train later to eliminate all the bad behaviors. So it's important whenever you get a puppy that you train a ton of what you want, and then you also, though, address the things that you don't want. Our puppy training protocols are 90% food, so we use the dog's daily food. So what we'll do with a dog is, say the dog needs 2 cups a day of dog food, and say it's a dry kibble. So what we'll do is we'll take the 2 cups of food, we'll put it on top of the dog's crate, and then during the day we use that dog's daily food to train the dog. And we all do all obedience training. You can use a marker, you can use a clicker, you can use anything you want to get that dog to understand what yes is and to get that dog to understand what you're looking for. We also highly recommend taking a slip lead on the dog and putting a slip lead on the dog's neck, or a very small thin martingale collar with a leash. One of the things that we find with a lot of our clients is they're not putting a leash on the dog with a collar, so the dog doesn't feel that pressure. Just having a leash drag, they don't feel that on it. So all of our puppy stuff is done with food. We reward all the good behavior, but you can actually correct unwanted behavior, and we'll talk about that, you know, afterwards. But let's just talk about the primary thing we do with puppies. This Facebook Live is motivated by, once I put up a post not very long ago where someone asked me, how long should a puppy be in a crate? And I was like, 18 to 20 hours a day for puppies that are anywhere from 8 to 12 weeks old. And they were like, wow, that seems like a long time. And it really does seem like a long time, but let me break it down for you. The only time that a puppy really needs to be out of a crate, and I'm not talking about a sport dog or a working dog, I'm talking about your average family dog, is during obedience training, structured play, eating, and actually you could, eating would be during training, and a little bit of free time, quote-unquote socialization. Most people, what they do is they keep the dog out of the crate too long, and they let the puppy free roam around their house. The problem with the puppy free roaming is this. It normally will soil, and it'll destroy things. You don't need your young puppy to see the whole house. So puppies should be contained to 1 or 2 rooms in the house. It doesn't need to get a tour of the whole house. If you've got a 2-floor house, it doesn't need to check out upstairs. But you absolutely want to get your young puppy used to stairs. So, but that doesn't mean he needs to go up there unsupervised and like investigate every room. Because all the dog is doing is, it's just looking for places to usually, unfortunately, to go to the bathroom in. So you want to make sure that you don't let your puppy free roam. We're a huge advocate of containment, so we want that dog, the puppy, remember, you're not raising a puppy, you're raising a dog, so we want that puppy, can you do that somewhere else, buddy? Thank you. Andrew's got this bubble machine that he got from Disney the other day, and it's just making a lot of noise right here. I know the microphone picks it up. So you want to make sure that puppy then understands how to go in a crate, fall asleep in the crate, and be super comfortable in the crate. So what kind of things can you do? Well, food training is great because, and it doesn't, we're not talking about treat training, we're talking about the dog's daily kibble. So what you can do is this, you can have the dog do recall to you. It's really easy to teach recall to a puppy. Why? It's really hungry and you've got food. So you can practice all your recalls. Now, whenever you're working with the dog, what we like to tell people to do is, there's a couple of different ways you can do it. You can either reward with food, or you can lure with food. It's two different things. There's a big difference in asking a dog to do something and then reaching into your food bag and giving the dog food. And there's a big difference between having the food in your hand and luring the dog into the position. Hold on 1 second. Can you please go over onto the grass area, buddy? Thank you. Awesome. Love you. That's Angelo. So he just handed me his little frog. And there's tons of lizards. Like, there's all these lizards right behind me. So recall. Call the little puppy over. So the puppy's name, say, is like Sammy. You know, Sammy here, that puppy comes running over to you. You know, you can have Sammy do a sit, and then you can teach Sammy break, boom, food reward. While the dog is eating the little pieces of kibble, you can walk over to the other side. I have a video on this. It's actually, I think it's called come, sit, break. While the dog is eating the kibble, you know, walk over 10 to 15 feet. When the dog is done with the kibble, you can say it again, Sammy here. Boom, that dog goes running over to you. So imagine you can use the dog's daily kibble to do 20 to 30 recalls and sits. So recall, sit, recall, sit. Then what you can also do is you can do recall, place, sit, reward, and then walk over again somewhere else. So you can do all kinds of great stuff with your puppies. The dog then learns right off the bat, coming to you, sitting down, not jumping on you, getting a food reward, not biting at you, going to place, with a down command, that's absolutely lure. We always lure dogs into a down, and we do that with food, and we drive the food into the dog's nose. Sometimes you can take the food and you can, if this is the dog, you can take the food and go this way, and then the dog tries to get it. Or you can take the food and you can drive it into the dog, and it can go into like a sphinx-like down. So you've got a couple of different options to do with food training for the down. Now what you're doing is like the second week of training, you had the down say. So now you're doing recall, sit, place, down. And you're not necessarily looking for duration right now. You're just looking for the dog to understand what the commands are. But keep in mind that don't give the word really until the dog understands it. Why? The word doesn't mean anything. So you can, and in teaching heel, you can do heel as well. So what you can do is right off the bat, by 10 weeks old, if you get these puppies at 8 weeks old, by 10 weeks old, with the dog's daily food, you can do every command. How awesome is that? Kennel up, be quiet in the crate. Now, whining in the crate. What do you do with a dog that whines in the crate? Some people are gonna say never correct the dog. But believe it or not, we always correct puppies in crates for whining and barking. How do we do that? Historically, what we'll do is we'll do a bonker. A bonker is just a towel wrapped up. You can take the little stainless steel food bowl. You can take your hand. Believe it or not, you can just hit the top of the crate, hit the side of the crates. You're not going to make the dog dislike the crates. That's really an old wives' tale. We've heard that so many times. We've never seen that at all with all of our clients that we give this advice to. So what you're doing is dog whines, dog barks, pop the side of the crates. Now, if a dog's been in a crate for 6 hours, a puppy, 8 to 12 weeks old, and it's whining, it most likely has to go out to the bathroom. So you want to have a good bathroom schedule. Make yourself an Excel spreadsheet, time of day, days of the week. So time of day up and down, days of the week, and start marking when it goes to the bath, when it goes outside, and what it does. Did it pee? Did it poo? And what we like to tell people, is this. Keep a leash on the dog, go to your door, same door every time, wait at the door, open the door, teach that dog threshold training. I've got a video on threshold training. Go outside to the same potty spot every single time. Go there. Now, some people are like, after the dog goes to the potty outside, give it a food reward. We just do praise. Good job, good potty. We just do that. Come back inside, put the dog back in the crate. Now, after maybe 5 or 10 minutes, then you can take the dog out of the crate. We always want to make sure the dog understands that when it goes to the bathroom, That's separate right now. You're going to come back in and go back in your crate. I want you to be calm in your crates. And then what I want you to do is, then what you can do is, we're going to bring you out, even if it's just a 5-minute wait, bring you out to work you. Let's see. There's a ton of stuff we do with puppies. Confidence building. What do you want to do with confidence building? I want to expose my puppies to as many sights and sounds as possible and surfaces. So I want the puppies to be able to walk on, like right now I've got, right in front of me, I've got, let's see, cement, pea stone, grass, dirt, carpeting. That's what I've got right now in front of me. So what I want you to do is I want you to make sure you expose that dog's paws to all those different surfaces. Also, what I want you to do is do this. Touch the dog's ears. Open the dog's mouth. Feel every part of its body. Fully extend its all its legs and its arms. Don't like hang them by the feet, but do a nice leg extension. Lift up the dog's tail. Press down on all their toes. Got it? I want that dog to understand you touching it. Now, what do you do when a dog nips at you, a puppy nips at you? The most common thing we do for puppy nipping is this. We do this super fast and super stealth. We take our thumb and we put it right into the puppy's mouth and we push down. All right? We push down. So I want you to do that as well. I want it to be super fast though. And the puppy might, you know, be uncomfortable. The puppy should be uncomfortable. What you can also do is you can also take its top lip and hold it down. And so if it bites, it bites into its own lips. You can do that. You can do that as well. So if the puppy bites on you, it should be uncomfortable. What we don't do is this, and I'm talking about family dog training. This is not a working dog. Family dog training, we don't want the dog to bite at all. So working dog, sport dog training, you might redirect, but right now with puppy dog training, I'd rather eliminate all the biting and then teach it how to play tug later. I'd rather do that. So let's eliminate the biting and then I can teach you how to play tug afterwards. So what we don't do is we don't do puppy bites you and then you come up with a thing to bite and then the puppy bites the toy. Because I don't want the dog to be asking you for that toy by nipping on you. All right? So that's what I want you to do. Let's see. There's that. The dog does not need a ton of toys. What we do is we recommend one soft and one hard toy. That's all they really need out. They don't need this wide selection of toys all over the place. If they destroy the soft toy, what we do is this. We have to eliminate it. So if a dog is always destroying soft toys, getting all the stuffing out of it, they just don't get soft toys anymore. That's what we do. If a dog is destroying their bedding, they lose the bedding. I think it's really important because what can happen is a dog can actually die by ingesting the bedding. Let's see, did we do that? Oh God, there's so many things we can do. Oh, have the dog start going up on surfaces and down surfaces. So teach the dog to like go up a piece of wood that's slanted, go down a piece of wood that's slanted. What's really, really good is go to a children's playground. Children's playgrounds are great for confidence building for puppies. Excellent things to do for puppies. It's really, really, really great for puppies to do that. Also, different sounds. You can play all kinds of sound effects around little puppies. So you can get a CD-ROM or download sound effects from YouTube, everything. Fireworks, shotguns, gunshots, street noises, horns, babies crying, a lot of different things. Start working on those things. Also, what you can do is you can start getting it all kinds of different people. Have it be around tons of different people. Deer antlers, yes. For a puppy with deer antlers, what I would do, Pat, is get the ones that are split in half already, because that's a little bit easier for the puppy to chew on. So I'm a huge advocate of having a dedicated chew toy for puppies as well. I'm probably forgetting a ton of stuff here, but I wanted people to know that if you're complaining about your puppy whining, you're the one that got the puppy. If you're complaining about the puppy nipping at you, you're the one that got the puppy. If you're complaining about getting up every 4 hours, you're the one that got the puppy. That's just the way it is. Puppies are very, very difficult to raise. They take a lot of time. But I also want you to remember, you can also correct puppies for doing different things. So what I want you to do is, the dog gets jumps up on you, you can use a little bit of a bonker. Bonker is a towel. You absolutely can bonk a puppy. You're not going to ruin the relationship. You won't make the dog afraid of you. The dog won't, like, you know, never trust you anymore. A lot of that is just old wives' tales and hearsays. Great trained puppy who shows teeth at other dogs bigger than her. You can use a bonker on that dog. For Rachel, I'm talking about like an 8 to 12 week old dog, maybe 14 weeks old. So I'm talking about when people are getting, what I'm doing is I'm targeting now people that get dogs like right from a breeder or right from a rescue or right from a shelter, right at the puppy age, which is 8 weeks old. So please don't get puppies younger than 8 weeks old. So I'm talking about the 8 to 12 week old period, maybe up to a 14 week old period, you want to be doing this stuff. Now that's not to say a 14 week old dog, a 16 week old dog, you can't be doing this stuff with, as well with, but also what we're doing is we're doing all food marker training with dogs this young. That's what we're doing. Also, we want the dog to understand what a leash feels on. So many dogs have never felt any leash on the dog, even a little slip lead, even a little martingale, even a flat buckle collar with dog tags. They've just never felt pressure on their neck. All right? Yes, Heather, you absolutely want to teach your dog what no means. What else? Housebreaking can be difficult. What I want to do is make sure you probably want to take off food and water about 4 hours prior to bedtime. You want to probably do that 4 hours prior to bedtime. You know, your dog's not going to be dehydrated and dog's not going to starve. It can last till the following morning. And what you can do is right before bedtime, I like to tell people to take the dog out 3 times. So say 10 p.m. is bedtime. 9:30, 9:45, 9:55, but the dog's in the crate in between that. So the dog's in the crate at 9:30, take it out, do the waiting at the door, bring it outside, all right? And then what I want you to do is go to the same tree, the same bush, come back in the crate, 9:45 and 9:55. That's what I want it to be. And it's not for play at all, it's for potty. Strictly potty time. The puppy grabbing the water bowl, what I like to do is I like to do hanging bowls. I like to take away the water bowl at night. So no water bowls in the crates at all. You can actually monitor your dog's water. So don't feel like you've got to give your dog access to water around the clock. Give your dog like official water time. As long as your dog is getting a regular water, you'll be fine. You'll be fine. Now, some people with really young puppies, they'll use those little hanging water bottles, like the larger rodents that people have, guinea pigs, like the little guinea pigs, or rabbits, the little rabbit things. You can also use that, which has the water come out much slower. You can also do that. But don't feel like you've got to have access to water overnight. You don't. Your dog is going to... Angelo, where are you, buddy? Awesome. Thank you. Don't feel like you've got to have your dog access to water around the clock. It'll be fine. It can last. It won't be dehydrated. That's a good start, I think. I think that's a really good start for a lot of people that are struggling with a lot of the puppy stuff. What I'm finding is that a lot of folks, what they're doing is they're getting puppies and they don't have the knowledge yet. So what I'm hoping people start doing is, I want, when you're about to get a puppy, become super, super knowledgeable about that dog prior to getting it. I want you to be able to meet that dog's needs before you get the dog. So I'm putting out, you know, we've always put out great information. We've never been puppy heavy at all. We don't work with a ton of puppies. We tend to work with dogs that already have got these established bad habits. They come into our board and train, but we're fully capable of working with puppies. The Monks of New Skeet has a fantastic book on puppy raising. Absolutely. And I've actually watched them raise their puppies. It's pretty, pretty incredible. They actually start on day one. 24 hours after that puppy is born, they start working on a lot of different climates. They'll put that dog like in an air-conditioned room, in a warm room. It'll touch something cold to its paws, something warm to its paws. Not like an iron, but a warm surface, a cool surface. They're also holding up the dog as well. Hold up the dog, get the dog to be calm when it's being held up. Simulate the vet visits. Leash pressure, you can start doing leash pressure by having the dog just drag around a slip lead. So put the dog on a slip lead right away. The minute you get that dog, it should go on a slip lead. And make sure it's the slip lead that you can lock. So it can't slip out of it. It can't slip out of it. Oh, good, Lindsay. I'm glad that helped. All right. So that's what I got for puppies right now. If you've got some comments or questions down below, feel free to do it. Don't forget, you can correct your puppy at a young age, but we don't correct for not complying for obedience. There's a big difference. We correct for some bad habits, so such as like whining in the crate, biting, jumping up, picking up things that it's not supposed to. That we correct. For not doing an obedience command, we don't correct young puppies at all. Everything we do is positive. All right? Everything we do is positive. But it's also balanced. I shouldn't say that. So with obedience, it's positive. Marker, you can click or train your dog as well. Just remember, everything that's positive, you're just reinforcing wanted commands. But for whining, getting in the trash, jumping up on things, jumping up on people, picking up things it's not supposed to, we absolutely punish the dog. And the best way to do that is usually a bonker, which is just a rolled up towel. You can also use a pet convincer, which is just a little canister of compressed air. It's a startle effect, punish effect. You're not gonna mess up the dog. The dog won't hate you. You won't ruin the relationship with the dog. You're not gonna make the dog afraid of you. A lot of that stuff that you hear just isn't true. At least we're not finding that it's true at all. All right? Yep. Deaf, no socks, no shoes, no undergarments, no Kleenex, no towels, no, if you've got children, no children's toys. All right, good. So another Facebook Live. I just wanted to get that information out there. Thank you all for the wonderful support from around the world. And we just adopted out another dog. Jeff's Pack just adopted out another dog today. Super proud of that wonderful couple that got that dog. If you haven't seen us yet on our Facebook page, we posted it on our Facebook page. I'm super proud of my staff who got that dog prepared. First of all, I'm super proud of Michelle in Hawaii who gets us these dogs, number one. I'm super proud of my staff who bust their butt. We do pro bono training. To get that dog ready for adoption. And I'm super proud of the two, the couple that came in that did their homework and came in to be trained on that new dog. And now we get to bring in another dog. And we do that all for free. That's all part of Jeff's Pack. All right. Somebody asked me, whining correct. Yeah. Yep, you do. All right. Yep, I'll be in Scotland. I'll be in Glasgow. Scotland, as well as West Sussex, which is, I believe, southwest of London. And I'll be there, and you go to rvdogtrainer.com, rvdogtrainer.com. All right? Okay, everybody. Madly in love with all of you. You're all doing great. Super proud of all the hard work you're doing, and take care. Bye. Oh, I'll do my Angelo and dog spot. One dog. Girl, cats. So one dog there. And Angelo there. And another dog. All right. Okie doke. That's it. Take care. Madly in love with you.